Hey, it's Willie Armellini from Flowers and Scents with your industry buzz. Today I have a wonderful interview with Bill LaFever. Bill LaFever is the president of the Bill Doran Company, and they've been buying up wholesalers left and right, so I thought we'd ask him what they're doing and how they're going to manage all this. And here's your answer. So without further ado, Bill LaFever. All right, Mr. Bill LaFever from the Bill Doran Company. Welcome to Flowers and Scents, and thank you for taking this little bit of time to spend with me today. So I'll get right to it, because you've been picking up wholesalers like shiny pennies. I can't keep track. How many locations do we have now?
31 facilities.
Now, you know, this brings me back to an SAF meeting years ago where Peter Moran suggested that back then it was 10 years, I think. He suggested there would only be five wholesalers left, or five large chains left, and then maybe some individual unique wholesalers. But that's becoming more and more true here, it seems. We're narrowing down the number of names that are involved here anymore.
Yeah, I sat in that audience as well. We called them mega wholesalers, but he said maybe there'd be 5 to 10 mega, but I think there's still a lot of room for niche wholesalers that he referenced as well. You know, smaller wholesalers that are fine tuned to certain aspects of markets that find their niche in there. So I think there's still a lot of room for a lot of other wholesalers, that's for sure.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I'm glad to hear that from your perspective, because wholesaling in general has been under attack from a lot of different angles, between the internet and buying direct and blah, blah, blah. You know, I mean, there's been a lot going on. So it's interesting to hear your perspective on that. I'm glad to hear that.
And in reality, I think most of our locations kind of operate as a niche wholesaler, very in tune to their local market. The flavor, the culture of each one of our locations is really just reflective of, the branch manager and their key salespeople and operations people. From a corporate perspective, we just really provide them the tools to be the most effective, to take out any of the repetitive tasks. We try to remove those and make it very easy for them. So, location to location, we're not overly standardized. We really let the locations operate in the best manner for their markets. And they're very different from market to market, that's for sure.
Yeah, I think maybe our motto is probably a good example of that. They were sort of the only wholesaler in that area, as far as I know anyway, remember. So for them to, for you to pick that up. Yeah, you're right. I mean, it's really, it's all about managers, as we know. I mean, I've had this discussion before. If you got a good manager, you can sort of tackle any market, or at least be willing to tackle any market. So 31 now. So that probably makes you the largest in terms of number of stores.
Probably, but also potentially the number of headaches as well, right?
Yes, and many people have told me that taking over one or a chain, any number of those is a really a big task, because you have their own culture and their own markets, their own way of doing business. So providing them with the back office stuff probably is a relief to many, I would think.
I think that's where we bring in the advantages for sure. The back office, all the administrative things, some of the marketing materials that then are customizable at the branch level, the relationships that we have with some growers and our buying office. We have individuals in Ecuador and Colombia, managed by somebody here in the States, Gary Staten, who does a great job for us.
Hey, a little bit of history here. Bill Doran Company has been around a long time. I worked with Bill way back when he was living in Fort Lauderdale, and he had his Guatemalan farm, and he about made us crazy, because he would want the flowers cleared. The moment the plane landed, he was on the phone. Okay, get them out of the, why aren't they on the truck yet?
Yeah, why not? Yeah.
And we battled a long time for that, but you still have that operation?
Nope, that did shut down shortly thereafter. I think you couldn't clear the flowers fast enough for us, so we had to abandon that.
it was a project. It was just roses too he was growing, yeah?
Yes, I think so. It was a partner that he had down there, and I think that ended, it was only a few year run, I think. It was well before my time.
Before your time. All right. And you have there because your grandfather was Bill Doran?
Correct. So he started the company in 1945. So my full name is actually William Doran LaFever. So my mom either cursed me or blessed me, depending on the day, with a middle name like that. So I'm officially Bill Doran LaFever.
All right. That makes a little more sense now to me. Hey, so let's talk about Valentine's for a minute. What do you see?
We're projecting a really solid Valentine's, that's for sure. The pre-books that we had in early December, we go out with a really early bird aggressive. We hit all of our targets there, which were real strong. We're now getting close to our next major cutoff at the end of this week, depending on the market, anywhere from January 6th to January 8th. And the numbers we're seeing, the retailers are booking with us. You know, they're trusting the salespeople. Even just same store, same location sales, I think are going to be fairly strong. We saw that with Thanksgiving, with Christmas, you know, all the way back into to Mother's Day. So we're pleased with where we're sitting right now. That's for sure. Just nervous with logistics. That's going to be from a wholesale perspective, from distribution, just getting the product out in time, out of South America, getting it into the U.S. and clearing customs. That's going to be, I think, you know, potentially where some bottlenecks are.
I agree, because as we know, the planes have been used for all sorts of purposes. The flowers become sort of secondhand here for the cargo airlines. They're running around with PPEs and all sorts of different things.
Sure.
Yeah, I think that's going to be probably the bigger challenge, getting product out of there and into stores. Okay, so your latest adventure was with Greenleaf. You took over some stores there. Happy to hear.
The latest was Amato on the November
16th. That's true.
Greenleaf was November 2nd.
Stuck them in the middle there. That was nice of you. And as a former Greenleaf employee, it was good for me to hear, actually, because I had worked with them for a long time and tried to do some good things for them. And it just seemed like it was unraveling. So I was happy to hear that you stepped in.
Yeah, I mean, there was got a call Friday morning that they declared bankruptcy. And to me, the key was the people, like we've talked about. So I just called the trustee and started having conversations with them. And I said, the most value from my perspective, what I'd be willing to pay will be, you know, Monday morning. You know, this was Friday morning. I said, you know, then by Tuesday, it's worth less. Wednesday, it's worth less.
Yeah.
And originally, he was saying it was going to go up for auction 4 weeks later. You know, they're just going to padlock the doors. The owners decided to do a Chapter 7, which, you know, is padlocking the doors and waiting 45 days for an auction. So I was able to have a quick conversation with the judge and explain my situation and what I thought would be most valuable to keep employees on board and employed, which was the valuable asset to me. And we were able to get a deal done by about noon Central time that Monday. Worked all week, and it was Halloween, and then November 1st, the trustee was a tremendous asset. So was able to be on the phone with him off and on all day Saturday and Sunday.
Yeah, not to mention that you had probably fresh flowers on the way to those Greenleaf stores and inventory in those stores dies quickly if you don't shut the door. It doesn't work. Wow. Well, that was a big one. So you got six of those stores, I believe, or?
We ended up getting five.
Five.
Because they had already started transitioning them. There was a handful that were already closed or in the process of closing. So we ended up with five. We ended up with Houston, Dallas, Texarkana, Portland, and Reno. Those were the remaining five.
And so one of those was the old United store, even, I guess.
Yeah, I think Texarkana was.
Texarkana was the only one that survived that.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay, so I don't even like talking about COVID anymore, but let's... How are you managing it at the store level?
You know, we really we took the focus of common sense and compassion. Those were the two key words that I just reiterated to all employees on our internal calls. And I said, you know, do what makes the most common sense for you personally, health wise, and then with compassion on the backside of it, knowing that our customers need flowers and need certain situations, and so, you know, some locations closed down to just a few hours a week. I'm sorry, a few hours a day. Other locations stayed open a little bit more, but we never closed a single store throughout the process. We kept flowers flowing into all of those locations, which I think was very, very important for our customers. We spent a fair amount of time lobbying our local developmental economic development offices in Illinois, New York, and Wisconsin and Iowa to not say that retail florists were an essential business, but to show that their potential to do delivery was the same as the pizza, like a pizza delivery, non-contact delivery. There was no reason to ban that since they already had a system in place. So we got letters confirming that early on in late March. Actually, it was probably by early April that we got confirmation letters that we were then able to show our retail customers that, hey, you can stay in business if you choose, if it makes common sense and for your situation. Not all customers did, but a lot did. And so that was important for us. So that was a lot of what we did early on with the COVID.
Did you, in general, do you find a lot of retailers did go out of business?
A lot is, I guess, is a
vague term. Right?
Yeah. We did not see it. We saw the event planners temporarily close, right?
Right.
And I think, I don't think, so I wouldn't call them out of business. I would call them, COVID closed. Yeah. And I think, as soon as those events come back, they'll be back. Maybe one or two of them may not make it back. I'm not sure. But traditional retail, we did not see major closures there, permanent closures. We're seeing the majority, high percentage come back, which is a great thing. I think if anything, just the whole, bringing everything more local is going to be just the whole thought process of the coronavirus and people, appreciating the local aspects of things will be beneficial. And I'm kind of going on a tangent. This wasn't your question, but I really think the retail florist has a tremendous opportunity with same day delivery and customization. I mean, that's what's so awesome. I think people are getting tired of the cookie cutter approach, and to be able to have that arrangement customized to exactly what they want, colors and textures and arrangement styles, and to still get it delivered on that same day, if the retailer stays active in their community, local community, and pushes on those things, I see them having a tremendous amount of success.
That's a good segue into my next question, which was about supermarkets. I mean, the supermarkets have stayed open and because of the food, and obviously they were sort of the first to keep the flowers going because they were open, for that matter, and there wasn't a lot of question about that. So I think, how do you view them? You see a supermarket as a competitor or is just somebody that's selling flowers?
I think you probably put it in two different ways there. I think they're an important component of the industry, that's for sure. We sell to many supermarkets, but I don't think it's at the expense of traditional retail. A lot of what we're doing with, a lot of what we see in mass market aren't necessarily the same people. The end consumer that's picking up at a supermarket is not necessarily the same end consumer that is calling the local retail flower shopper or browsing through their store looking for gifts and things like that.
Good point. That's a good point.
So I think there's, is there competition amongst them? Of course there is. There's only, there's only so much demand for flowers out there, but it'd be like trying to say, Outback is a competitor of Capital Grill. Sure.
Right.
Yeah. They are.
They sell food, right? Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and they sell steak and they're nice and they both do a very nice job, but you're looking at them at different reasons, right?
Okay. So what else? You're going to have any more surprises for me coming up?
Your plate's full. Yeah, I'm very fortunate and blessed with the crew of people I have at our corporate office and support. I think if I tried to do anything else right now, I might have a little bit of a mutiny. I think, what they've absorbed, I think we brought the Secret Riccardi acquisition in mid-October, then the Greenleaf, and then the Amato. I think with all employees, it was almost 250 employees brought on board in about a 8-week period of time, and all those sales and all that information, just having to come together. I can't ask anyone to do any more.
fair enough. And speaking of Secret Riccardi, I always liked that concept. They had that gigantic board on the wall. They were really ahead of their time.
Oh, completely ahead of their time for sure. Yeah, how they're selling off the almost more like a Miami-based company selling slots and inventory, live inventory on the walls.
Yeah, it was very clever. I thought that was very interesting. And you told me at the beginning of this that you might have a question for me or two.
Oh, yeah. I just felt that you do a lot of these interviews, and I thought, well, let's turn the tables a little bit back on to you. I'm sure your viewers and listeners might actually be more inclined to listen to interesting things from you. So I did jot a couple down here, so I'll just kind of read them. Single biggest floral industry mentor for you? Who had the biggest impact on your floral career as an individual?
My quick gut reaction is my father.
Well, perfect.
It's because he was all about the flower business. Growing up as a kid in the flower, well, growing up in the trucking business, you see, I can't even differentiate. I grew up in the flower business. We had trucks, but I knew more about flowers than I knew about trucks.
If you were managing, let's say, a flower farm, what would be your number one focus? If you were helping a farm, what would be the biggest focus?
Innovation. I think innovation, because I've had people call me up at different times of my career and saying, hey, I've been out of the business and I want to get back into business. What should I do? I said, go out to the forest and find, or go to wherever, the Amazon, find flowers that nobody's ever seen before. Try to find something different. I think at the time I recommended calla lilies because they were not as popular at the time. And obviously quality, and the bar is set so high at this point. So you have to have great quality and you have to have good varieties. I think, the world is always looking for something new. So that would be my thought.
Well, if you were a wholesaler, what would be your one focus area?
Service. It's just about service, because a wholesaler is just a middleman in the grand scheme of things. So if you don't provide good service, you can't, it's just not going to work. Or
totally makes sense.
Somebody else is going to out-service you.
And any thoughts on retail operations? What would be the best focus?
Man, growing up, I have to tell you, one of the biggest fears was going in. My mother would drag me into the local florist shop in Vineland, New Jersey. And it was so damn intimidating. Don't touch anything. And how much was that? And what are we getting? And it was, I have to tell you, it was an intimidating experience. So I have been in, as you might imagine, a whole bunch of retail shops and wholesale shops. And you go into a retail shop, and if you didn't see flowers, or the flowers are in the back of the building or the back room or something, it was not friendly. I have been to many which are quite friendly, where they have, a wine bar, perhaps even, or a cappuccino or something that's very, very comfortable and customer friendly. I think many of them
have been walk-in business.
Yeah, the walk-in business. I always, a few people would ask me, what would you do? And I said, I'd put buckets outside. Put some flowers in buckets and put them out on the sidewalk and let attract people in like bees.
Yep. What would be a bold prediction for 2021 flower industry? Like 10% chance of it actually happening. Just what's on the fringe in your mind of what you're hearing and seeing, or your best or most recent book you've read?
Gosh. That's an embarrassing one. I think in my life, I've read about 10 books in my life. Some of them were the same. There was books I had to read in school. As a musician, I just don't read. I don't know if it's about music.
No, I was just going to say my next question, we'll just shift that one, is what's your favorite song, knowing that you're a musician? Do you have an all-time single favorite song?
Oh, it has to be a Beatles song. Fool on the Hill was always a good one for me.
Ah, very good. I would stay on that same topic. Well, favorite variety, favorite flower or variety of?
Ooh, a peony.
Perfect.
They've always been good to me.
Yeah, beautiful. And lastly, any New Year's resolutions you would share with your listeners?
I'll steal one from somebody else and say, pee before you go.
There you go. Well done. That was all I had.
As we're getting older, that's more important than it's been in years past. Hey, thank you for this time. I appreciate it. You've been generous with your time. And thanks for asking me questions. You put me on the spot here. I'll have to think about that. But and I'll get back to you on that one. I'll think about that.
Perfect. You can edit it right into the.
I can edit it right in. Yeah.
Cut that out when you said you're not sure and just put in a little blurb.
I'd be happy to. All right, so I will do that for you as well. I'll edit this and get it back to you. And again, thank you for your time and good luck with all you're doing here. And
thank you. Appreciate it. We need it all we can get, that's for sure.
Congratulations. And so you have a great day. Thank you, sir.
Thanks. You too. Bye-bye.
Bye now.